Well, 9/11 is, I haven't seen any textbooks, but I'm assuming they're in history textbooks now. They're being printed all over the world, handed out everywhere. And for me, I wasn't in school when that came out, but I imagine they're out now. If anybody has some, send me some pictures so I can see. But this is why I talk about these things, because they're blatant lies. And of course, they won't go into much. The first title will be a terrorist attacked and blah, blah, blah. So it's not really going to investigate it. So that leaves people like the show, people like Dr. Wood, people like Dr. Reynolds to investigate these things, because clearly everyone else has given up. And before, I just want to connect a point you were saying about $20 million. Dr. Wood's book, the production didn't quite cost $20 million, did it?
No, even if we valued her time at $100 an hour,
she wouldn't even come close to like $700,000-$800,000. She wouldn't even come
I mean, it's a very good point. We have had a thorough investigation of 9/11, the most important site being the World Trade Center. But it was done on the cheap, wasn't it? And I recommend anybody who's serious about investigating 9/11 to go to the site wheredidthetowersgo.com mm-hmm. and order her book.
Absolutely.
Which is, it's not available in an e-form, but it's available in a beautifully produced 500-page glossy, lots of pictures, diagrams, a very thorough scientific tour that most any intelligent person can understand without the benefit of a serious scientific background. It's just a magnificent piece of work. And I'm proud to say that the first few years I helped her out, we talked nearly every day, and kind of the format was, looky here, look what I found, you know, and then she'd bounce it off me. And then I can't remember exactly how we would write it up, but at least at the outset, I was the better writer. And but it was just, it was so much fun early on. And then really the last half of the book was, on her own, you know, she could fly high without my help. And it's just, I feel like a, you know, a dissertation supervisor with a, you know, brilliant student who just knocked it out of the park. I mean, it's the book of the decade, you know?
Oh, absolutely. And it's quite a book for people should have it, because my problem was I watched all the specials like fine. I downloaded so many audio things, but I needed something in my hands that in case people brought it up, or something that I could bookmark, something that was, you know, complete in my hands, wasn't on a hard drive. I didn't need to boot up a computer, you know? And then once I got the book, it was like, wow, this is all, it's organized in a fairly good way to have a reference point. You know, you could literally turn to any page and it's gold. And it's funny because you compare that to something like the Toronto Commission's report or whatever, 9/11. I checked out a bunch from the library, a whole stack of them, 7 or 8 books, and they were pretty much all text and all nonsense. I mean, stuff about where the hijackers hung out, stuff about where who was on where, this, that, and you know, even the thermite stuff, there was like basically nothing, you know. That's kind of good to go into. I don't know how much you listened to with my interview with Andrew Johnson, but did you catch all the Richard Gage stuff?
You know, I need to go back and do some more work. I was into it for about 30 minutes, and I love Andrew and his work, so I got to go back. But tell me more.
Okay, so basically, Richard Gage, he came on to Reddit. Reddit's this kind of, it's like a message board online, but it's more set up like a website, like a Tumblr. So various people in the community vote stuff up and down, and it gets put, but it's pictures, it's links, stuff like that. Then they have what it's called subreddits, and there's sections of this website that are dedicated to a specific thing. So this happened to be the conspiracy subreddit, and Richard Gage was doing an AMA. An AMA means Ask Me Anything. So he came on, and I worked out this long thing. There's links everywhere, you guys can see it. I had a bunch of parts of the question. He basically kind of told me, first of all, he linked me to the Architects and Engineers FAQ site, and some people were kind of like, you come here to do an AMA and you link them to another site, and then people were like, can you answer his question, blah, blah. So he eventually got to the point where he's like, okay, which one? And I'm like, go ahead, pick anyone you want. Then he's like, well, you pick one, because I don't want to be accused of not picking, or whatever. So I picked the lack of sound point, and I kind of basically was saying how when an explosion happens and it breaks the sound barrier, which it does, there's no avoiding it. You're going to get a loud bang. Why can we hear people's voices on the street while WTC7 is destroyed? And in his explanation, he was like, well, that's a good point. He basically said that he inferred, I don't have the exact quote right in front of me, but he said that he said perhaps a form of thermite that was used that converted more energy into heat and light rather than wasting it on sound. And he actually and it's like, Richard, that's not what happens when explosion. It's unavoidable. The air comes back together, you get a clap, yeah. It clips the microphone and these explosions. So even if it was that, where's the heat and the light? I don't see it. I see a little bit of red stuff dripping. I don't see much else. So that was a major thing of starting this podcast, because I'm like, wait, this person is an architect and engineers for 9/11. He's the founder. Also, too, I found out a guy confronted him. The guy said, well, I heard that you make about $100,000 a year, whatever, 80 to 100,000. And he actually answered it. I was surprised. And he said, yes, I make a varying salary from 80,000 to 100,000 a year, but this is my life's work or something. And it's kind of like, okay, well, fuck if
Judy. Okay. In other words, he draws a salary for the organization, architects and engineers, huh?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And he confirmed that he makes 80 to 100,000 before taxes. He didn't mention anything about expenses paid or whatever. But he draws a salary, and $100,000 a year is nice. And I've heard him in one other interview where he said something. He's like, I spend 40 to 80 hours a week, whatever. But like I said to Andrew, I do this on my own. I do it for free. I'm not looking for money. Dr. Wood's not looking for money. I mean, just to cover costs of books. Same with Andrew Johnson. If you want a physical book, same thing. You got to pay costs. It's unavoidable. But and this guy's getting paid $100,000, and this is the bullshit he comes up with.
Yeah, and I know who's, I can't remember right off the top of my head. This researcher from Ohio has looked into the fundraising aspect, and it just for architects and engineers, and raises this whole question: how can they? Where are they really getting their money? You know, it wasn't obvious. It wasn't easy to track down, is what I'd say.
No, and the guy, he confirmed to us that that he does make that amount, which I thought he just wouldn't answer that question, you know, and he confirmed. So what must be going through his mind?
Well, they are a good example of what V.I. Lenin famously said, or at least it's a cliche, and that is, we shall control the opposition by leading it. So you can't just look at, here comes some people that are 9/11 truthers. Mm-hmm. Well, are they gullible sheep, or are they wearing a white hat and they're really black hats? What's going on here? You've got to separate out the people who are doing honest work and good work from those who are misleading. Now, Richard Gage is a dishonest person. Mm-hmm. You know, he is a phony baloney. You cannot take a Building 7, for example, and say, well, this is a controlled demolition, because there are too many facts that falsify that proposition. And he's smart enough to know better. For example, you know, the seismic equivalent was 0.7, mm-hmm. You know, which is less than a jackhammer trying to break up some concrete. And here you've got 240,000-ton building. Yep. And another aspect is you talked about the sound, and that's a very relevant point, but also on sound in a controlled demolition, or all the steel, if it were allegedly falling, there'd be a lot of creaking.
Oh, yeah. You know, oh, yeah.
A noise of steel, metal on metal. And there's none of that. The whole thing is just silent.
Yep.
And what you end up with, because of all the powderization, the dustification of that building during the day, and you can see it in Dr. Wood's book, you know, from the various pictures there. And you can go online and see it on YouTube. But basically, the building was hollowed out. That's how it was so quiet. You know, it's basically the hull or the husk of that building. And that helps us to account for other otherwise seeming anomalies, like the small amount of material that was left and the fact that
it didn't spill over.
Virtually nothing, the adjacent buildings were little harm.
Well, it's amazing, too. Before we start talking about that, I'll just mention that Richard Gage, he's an architect. He worked in San Francisco or whatever. And when he was asked about the seismic data for 9/11, he said something about that wasn't his area of expertise. Well, how is he an architect in San Francisco if he doesn't know how to interpret seismic data?
Yeah. Somebody was insulting. What's an architect? You know, it's a guy with some blueprints and an interior decorator's certification. but obviously you need structural engineers and the like to deal with earthquake-prone building. But still, for him to plead complete ignorance and it's outside my area of expertise is come on. You cannot be serious.
That's why I was careful with what I said to him, not to mention Dr. Wood or anything that was close to her name or kind of hinted right at it or directed at energy, because I saw the way he deals with people that say that, like Abraham Rodriguez and some things even on that message board, you know, the way that other people dealt with that. So I really had to focus and make sure there was nothing about that, because I didn't want him just to pawn it off just to tell me to go somewhere like he tried to and look somewhere. It's amazing what there's also something else I'll mention about him real quick before we go. There's one girl that posted and she posted, "I don't have a question, Richard, but I want to thank you so much for doing this." This is paraphrasing it. And then he posted after, he said, "Hey, Emma Williams XXX," that was her name. He's like, "Are you single? Smiley face."
What?
Yeah, I have it right here. It's saved.
Yeah.
I understand, like I told Andrew, I understand liking to joke a bit, but that's just borderline creepy, and this is too important to joke about. But yeah, he literally said after she says thank you for whatever, he said, "Hey, Emma Williams, are you single?" and I have that screenshot of that, and I'm pretty sure it's still up in the AMA. So these are the type of people that are leading the circus, you know? You're never going to see Mike Sicetta on the street in a trance with Alex Jones yelling about 9/11 to a news reporter, you know? That's just not who I am, and that's not the way I feel things are going to get done. Things are really going to get done by communicating with people like yourself, like Dr. Wood, like Andrew Johnson, and kind of building a network like that, you know, without being in a specific group. Andrew Johnson and I were talking about kind of the dangers of getting rallied up into a group. Actually, if you want to talk about that for a bit, because you had the same experience, you were part of the original Scholars for 9/11 Truth, I believe, and you started noticing that there were some fishy things going on.
In fact, I did an article early on that's on my website where I drew a parallel between what George W. Bush was saying and what a lot of people in the 9/11 truth movement were saying. And that is, they keep using the word unity. Unity, right? Well, let's gather together and all, behind what flag? I mean, what's in the Constitution that we're supposed to pledge allegiance to? I'm in favor of a more competitive world of independent thinkers. And yes, if we arrive at proof for various propositions exposing the government's lies, we can all sign on that. But, come on, there's going to be dissenters and it should be allowed. I mean, it's a free field and no favor is what we should be behind. So, yeah, and now when it came to the Scholars for 9/11 Truth, we had the parting of the ways between Fetzer and Stephen Jones, and trying to sort this out is, I just end up saying whether you're well-intentioned or not is a secondary to whether you're actually advancing the truth mm-hmm. or not. Okay.
Or wasting time.
Or wasting time by immersing us in these mud fights. So, sometimes you've got to. I did one essay where I said I headlined it "Fed Up with Fetzer." You know, it's just you end up saying, "Well, come on now, this is just childish stuff." You know, so go your own way. But have your ideas tested and make mid-course corrections where needed. If somebody finds out, hey, here's some convincing evidence that you were wrong on this or that, and hey, I've changed my mind.